Tell your friend you'll see him afterwards in the parking lot or at the restaurant. Unless you brought your lunch, you can eat at the parking lot with your lunch and see your friend. Do it all in one visit. Amen. Come on in, everybody. Have a seat. Let's get started. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, I want to officially welcome you this morning in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Hallelujah and amen to that. All right. I've got a couple of announcements to make. Miss Barbara Kersey, where are you? Come on up here. I know you got something cooking today. Hot off the presses.
Young at Heart is going to have lunch at the Olive Garden on Highway 6 and Highway 59 and Sweetwater. So if you're going, it's under my name, and they may have to pull more tables together, but that'd be great.
Wow, that was quick. All righty. Quick note, the healing service has been moved to July 9th. Everybody say July 9th. Healing service. Say it, healing service. I'll be there. Oh, got quiet. Okay. I'm just checking. See who had the coffee and who didn't. Praise the Lord. Camp His Way is starting. How many folks have kids in the ages of 6 and 12 years old that go upstairs? You need to send your kid to Camp His Way. There's going to be information on the back table. Miss Deanne Duggar is organizing that for kids camp. I've been to kids camp several times. I mean, it's a power-packed 2.5 days. It's nonstop from the moment they get off the bus till they get on the bus, and everybody sleeps on the way home because they're so tired. It is a wonderful opportunity, and there's a lot of kids that receive Christ there, so it's really good. They put on different activities and shows and lots of fun and things for them to do for the whole 2 days. So go to that back table back there and get some information about it. If your kid is within the ages of 6 and 12, they need to go. Amen. All right, family movie night is coming. How many people came to family movie night last time? Yeah. I'm going to tell you, if you didn't come, you missed something really good. You know, a few of us families who are a little bit competitive, I'll say that, had us a little fierce game of Taboo going on. We got a little loud, but we're going to have a rematch. I do want to say the men against the women. That can always get loud. And we lost, but we want a revenge. We want an opportunity to regain the title of Taboo Champion for Freedom Center Church. Amen? Family game night, guys. Come on, bring your kids out, have some food, some fun, and we just have a good time and we'll fellowship together. Amen? Amen. Visitors, if you're visiting with us for the very first or second time, we'd like to recognize you. I'd just like for you to stand up for a quick second and just wave at me. If you're visiting with us, this is your first or your second time. There you are. Please remain standing. Please remain standing. Our ushers are going to rush right over and bring you a gift packet with some information about our church. We ask that this afternoon or later today or tomorrow, take a few moments and look through the information. If you got questions, you can always call the church, and we'll be more than happy to answer those questions for you. Inside that packet, there are two cards for you. One is a visitor card. We ask that you complete the visitor card so that we would have a record of your visit. Take that card to the back table underneath the monitor there, and we're going to give you a nice little Chick-fil-A gift card so you can go out and have a little bite on us. Amen? The second card applies not only to you but to everyone. It's a prayer request card. And I say this every week. Our staff prays over each and every prayer request card that's turned in. So you miss an opportunity if you don't turn one in for us to be standing with you with what you're believing God for. You know, the Bible says we have the power to cast 1,000 and two have the power to cast 10,000. That's an increase in a multiple of 10 when two people come together. So do the math. If you got about 7 or 8 staff members standing and agreeing with you at what you're believing for, you imagine how we magnify God's power for you on your behalf and the things that you're believing and trusting God for? Amen? Amen. So Make sure you get that prayer request card filled out, put it in the offering tray, and just believe and have faith, exercise faith that God's going to do what he's going to do. Amen? Amen. I do have a word of encouragement for you today, and it comes by way of a God placed this on my heart. I was at the prison on Tuesday night. We do the Bible study with the men at the prison on Tuesday night, and one of the pastors, the prison inmate pastors of a church, said he wanted to talk to me afterwards. He had a word from the Lord for me. So he read out of Hebrews chapter 12. He read these two verses, and at the moment, it didn't mean a whole bunch. It didn't. It really didn't. I said, okay, I received that, and I believe that God will reveal to me later what it means. Well, within 4 or 5 days, he revealed to me. I just realized that this is the gentleman that we prayed for. He lost his father, who was a pastor, about 3 months before, and we men at the table in Israel tell you he was there for this, and we prayed for him, and we helped him get past what he was dealing. Well, my father passed yesterday. I got to read this scripture to you. It just really blessed my life because God's put out a command and a challenge, not only for me, but I'm going to share this with you. It's Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. It says this. It says, strive to live in peace with everybody and pursue that consecration. What it says in a different translation, it says, make every effort to live in peace with everybody and pursue that consecration and holiness without which no one will ever see the Lord. And then it says, exercise foresight. It says in the NIV translation, see to it. And what he said to me is that God is commanding you to do this. Make every effort to live in peace with everybody. Strive for holiness, because without holiness, you will not see the Lord. He says, see to it. It's your responsibility. It's your responsibility as a Christian to see to it. Hallelujah. And be on watch to look after one another, to see that no one fails back from and fails to secure God's grace, his unmerited favor and spiritual blessing, in order that no root of resentment, hallelujah, shoots forth and causes trouble and bitter torment, and many become contaminated and defiled by it. God is saying it's our responsibility as Christians, as believers, that we are to see to it that no one falls, no one falls between the cracks, no one misses an opportunity to receive the grace of God. So I challenge you today with that in mind. For 25 years of my life, I had a bitter root towards my biological father until God began to show me that I'm supposed to be striving. I'm supposed to be seeing after it, that we live in peace and that we resolve the issues. And for the last 22 years, I've had a great relationship with him. He went home to be with the Lord yesterday, and praise God that he is in heaven. Praise God that he is in heaven. So the command is that you are to make every effort to live in peace with everybody. And it's your responsibility as a Christian to see to it that no one falls between the cracks, that we are to pray for people. We are to go to them and be with them when they need us. As Christians, it's our responsibility, and it's your command. It's a commandment from the Lord for you to do it, for me to do it. We're to live by it. Amen? If you agree with that, amen. You accept the command and the challenge of God today? Amen.
In the first service, and I want to do it again right now. We're just going to pray over Tracy and for his family. And it's just as it is, the way God works. Here he is heading up for vacation, starting today. They're leaving today on vacation, and then this happens yesterday, and the Lord's ordained it, and nothing happens by accident. No such thing. And so, Father, we just pray, Father, your peace, your comfort, your spirit, Lord God, your presence over Tracy, over his family, over Toy, over his children, and over his siblings, Lord God, over all that will be there, Father, for the services. And Lord God, through all of it, that you be glorified. And Lord, Tracy sits here just a testimony of your grace and your goodness, Lord God. And his family is a testimony of your grace and your goodness. Even, Lord, not just salvation, but reconciled things, Lord God. That things are reconciled in his own heart and mind, Lord God. That he's able to come to a place of just perfect peace because he knows, Father, he's followed your steps and your forgiveness and reconciliation. And we just give you praise and thanks, Father, for that peace and reconciliation that he's experienced, Father, in these last years of relationship with his father. And we thank you for that. And so I just pray, Father, that your safety on them as they travel. And Lord, just that their steps are ordained, Lord God, that you have assignments, you have just through conversations, through embracing, through hugs, Lord, just through a smile, through a tear, through every emotion, Lord God, and every just pull of the heart, Lord God, that you're just going to minister through them. And Lord, that their vacation also would just be a time of refreshing. And Lord God, it'll be rejuvenating to them. And Lord God, a sweet time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You ready to worship? I got some news for you. The world in which you live is a mess. But nothing's thrown God off of his throne.
Amen.
He still rules and reigns and is in control. Amen. He's still the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so I want you to stand up and worship. Give him the glory. He is worthy.
America, stand.
God. Stand up and bless the Lord. Stand up and bless the Lord. Stand up and bless the Lord. Awesome God, He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Your marvelous things are glorious. Your love has made victorious. You took away the fear in us. Now we praise you because you can deliver us. There ain't no stopping us.
No!
No! Come and clap your hands with us.
Come and clap your hands with us.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Your marvelous things are glorious. Your love is victorious. You took away the fear in us.
Awesome God, He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
He reigns.
He reigns. He reigns. He reigns. He reigns. He reigns.
Lord reigns. Just worship Him. Here we go.
He reigns. Awesome God, He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Our God
is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
awesome, Lord. You are awesome, God. Mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes this whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. For all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Amen. Amen. I want to ask you to be seated. We're going to take the Lord's Supper together.
And just to do exactly what we just sang, this is what you've done for me.
Amen.
And do this often in remembrance of what you've done for me. Thanking him for his body that was broken for you, that his blood that was poured out for you, and his grace, his mercy. Whew.
Amen.
God is good. So I make a mess of myself, amen. I've already done that. And his grace is just so awesome. I mean, my journey, my life, every one of us could say that, of things that you could even attest to the mistakes that I've made, what the enemy meant for harm, God worked it for good. I'm so thankful of his hand on my life, his grace, his mercy. So we want to partake of the Lord's Supper, and it's just to do that very thing that Tracy was setting up us up with this morning, that just to inspect yourself, your own heart. Consider your own heart. That's what that's what this time is for. You know, we're otherly minded. No greater love hath any man than to lay down his life for another. You know, we pray every Sunday when we pray as a worship team. We pray, Lord, we know there's a benefit of worship. And we ask, Lord, let that benefit fall on others. Or whoever needs it this morning, let it fall on others. But this moment is the time for you to be self-centered, just for a moment, to deal with your own heart. Lord God, that you would just inspect our hearts as we partake this morning, as we break bread and as we sip the wine, as we partake of your blood, Lord God. Lord, all these things that were done for us on Calvary, we go back to Calvary right now in this moment. Doesn't matter what's going on in the world, what it looks like, just like it was for those disciples 2,000 years ago. They were living in a mess. We're living in a mess. But nothing changes the throne of God. Nothing changes the gospel or the message of Christ, that your blood is atoning. Your blood changes us and transforms us. We have a new king that lives inside of us, a new ruler, a new standard of which we live by. And so we thank you. And so we want to come this morning as we partake, and allowing you just to inspect our hearts, the way we think, our ways, Lord God, and how we treat others, everything, Lord God, everything about ourselves, Lord God, that you would just inspect it as we come and we partake. And we thank you for the body, and we thank you for the blood, in Jesus' name. And what I'd ask is that we're going to have the elders that are here, if you'd come forward, and they're going to partake first so that they can turn around and serve you, and that they can just receive with their families here, and then the ushers will direct you. They'll have you leave towards the left, and then you'll come back on the right. And I didn't have to turn around to say that this time. But just follow their lead. But there's what's most important. Even now, if you see somebody that's sitting around you that's by themselves, snatch them up. We want families to do this. We want dads to lead, and we want husbands and wives, certainly, but we want everybody that's here, because we're all family. And so if you see somebody that's by themselves, grab them. If you're by yourself, don't be bashful. Jump in with somebody, and let's just partake of the Lord's Supper together, okay?
us close to you. We draw near, Lord, as we cleanse our hands. We draw near, Lord. We join our souls as one with you. We draw near, Lord. We press close to you. We draw near, Lord, as we cleanse our hands. We draw near, Lord. We join our souls as one. This is your word. This is your promise. This is what you say you'll do. If we draw near, you draw near. You pull us close and dispel every fear. If we draw near, you draw near. You come beside us and draw.
We draw near.
Jesus, I need to know true love. Deeper than the love found on earth. Take me into the King's chamber. Let me know the kisses of your mouth. Let me feel your warm embrace. Let me smell the fragrance of your touch. Let me see your lovely face. Oh Lord, take me away. Even the soul. Let me feel your warm embrace. Let me smell the fragrance of your touch. Let me see your lovely face. Oh Lord, take me away. Even so, Lord, come, Lord, come. I'm We have nothing but you, O God. You are our rock, our strength, our shield, our mighty fortress, O God. You are the truth. You are the way. We have nothing but you, O God. We know we lived in a messed up world, but we are living in a mighty kingdom. Mighty kingdom of God. Mighty kingdom of God. You are not moved or swayed. You rule, you reign, you are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Thank you, Lord, that you loved us so much that you looked up at a messed up world and you sent Jesus to pay the price. That we really can't come here and sing those words that we love you more than life. That Lord God, that we are no longer in condemnation. We are no longer under a sentence of death, that we can come and break the bread and drink the wine, and we can thank you in remembrance of what you did for us upon Calvary. We thank you that you were slain even before the foundations of the world. So much of it, Lord, goes beyond our comprehension, Lord God. But we thank you, Lord God, for your grace and your mercy that you've shown us. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. And all that's within me, I bless your holy name, because you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Won't you be seated?
Okay. Good morning. Tuesday night, I'm so excited because we are going to have our Girls Night Out social. It's going to be a little bit of a different atmosphere, but the purpose for this night is to encourage you ladies, to encourage you. We all need encouragement, and we're going to be having some testimonies that night that are going to bless you. And if you are in a faith crisis or if you just need some encouragement, please come and bring someone who's walking through someone who's walking through so that they can be filled up with faith. So please come Tuesday night, all of our women. I look forward to seeing you. We'll start at 6 o'clock with food and fellowship, and then at 7 o'clock we will have praise and worship and then some powerful testimony. So I look forward to seeing you then.
Dove hunters. Okay, this is probably the last time I'll get up and talk about this because the window is closing on the sign-up. There are 10 fields. The fields have been planted with milo and rice, so it's going to be a dove attractant. I can give you the particulars on what's going on, but there's a sign-up sheet back on the back table back there to sign up for it if you haven't already. So if you haven't and you're interested in that, the sign-up sheet's back there. I'll be back there after service, and we can talk about the particulars. So, Aaron, I think you're next.
Good morning, everyone. Guys, we had an amazing week at YFN. Oh, my goodness. There are my guys over there. Guys, it's hard for me to put into words what happened this whole past week. The theme for the week was Genesis and just going back to the beginning of things. And so instead of me talking, I want to call up a couple of my kids to have them share. So can I get Andrew and TJ, and let's see, Madison and Amanda. Madison and Amanda. Come on up. Come on up over here, guys. Let's line up. There we go. So, Dalton too. Dalton, come here. Let's go, man. So, all these guys, I really could call up all of my kids and they could share something that God hit them with. But these are just a couple of the highlights because all of them have amazing, amazing stories. If you talk to any of them that went, a couple of our kids began speaking in tongues. Some have words of wisdom, words of knowledge. It was just an amazing time. So, TJ, I want you to talk about.
All right. So, this is my fifth year at YFN. And, well, one of the interns, she asked me, what year did you like the most? And I was like, well, all of them. I mean, because, you know, being in God's presence is just awesome, you know. And, this year, a YFN, you know, the theme was Genesis. And I was just thinking, Genesis. So God must be, like, trying to start something, you know. I mean, I've been in a relationship with God for a lot of years now. And just being with him. You know, it's made me feel awesome, you know. Like, I'm truly blessed, you know.
Awesome. Good morning, church. I said, good morning, church. I think this was my seventh or eighth year at YFN, and then every year it just gets better. This year, I had a couple encounters, but the one that happened the best, I think, was on Thursday, when Pastor Banning preached, he talked about the call. And to me personally, I felt like I had so many missed calls. It was just red on my phone. It was like, God, missed call. I answered about three or four of them this week. And the one that stuck out to me the most was he painted a picture in my head. And it was me on a football field. And I was wearing a green jersey. And probably if YFN was in December, I don't know what that would have meant. I was like, my high school team's blue. What are you talking about? But I got accepted into North Texas a few weeks ago, so that's where I'll be heading. And it was just me in a crowd full of people, just cheering for our team. And I'm on the sideline. Our defense is out there, and I'm just, let's go, D. Come on, we gotta win this game. And then another one. Was I don't know if anybody live streamed YFN, but their stage is up here and it goes far back, and I saw myself on a stage like that, like this, with a mic in my hand, and nobody was gonna take it from me. No, I'm just kidding. No, but it's it was another way of me reaching out to people, whether it's through football or me singing. My actions do speak louder than words. So what I do on the field, what I do up on stage, it's all for the glory of God and the audience of one. So that's what my call was this week.
This is my first year going, and I was kind of nervous to go because, like, I like going to church camps, but I didn't really know anybody, and I didn't feel like I really wanted to go. But I got there, and when we went to the evening service, like the praise and worship, it was amazing, and I just felt different there. So every night when they were preaching, I listened, but I didn't really put two and two together, and I felt like, okay, well, I don't feel anything. I don't see anything happening. But the last night he was talking about, you know, when you come to a church camp, you get changed, but you go back and you're going to the exact same situation you were in. And you have to change, like you have to change what you do, and you have to talk about God. You have to, you know, push and tell them about it. So it's like, okay. And so they called all the youth pastors up there and the interns and said, you know, if you want to go and you want to make that change, you come up here and get prayed for. So I went up there and I waited in line for Pastor Aaron to pray for me. And when he put his hands on my shoulders, I just started crying. Like, I don't think I've ever cried this much. And he got everything that's been going on, he talked about it and he prayed for me and more. And I felt everything go away. And I just felt like a relief, and it felt really good.
Hi, I'm Amanda, and this is my second year at YFN, and I just wanted to share something, like an experience, something that happened. So it was the last night, it was on Thursday, and the pastor said, if you needed healing, then raise up your hands. And then, so I was next to this girl, Samantha, she was my roomie, and she raised up her hands, and he said, the interns go up to them and pray, whoever you see in the audience, and no one came up to her. And so when they were done praying, he said, come to the front and say what you got healed for. And then he said, if you still didn't get healed, like, raise your hand still. And then so still no one came up to her. And I just felt in my heart that I needed to pray for her, like I had to. So God was telling me to. So I didn't touch her, but I put my hand out towards her, and I just said what came to my heart, and I thought what God was telling me to say. And when I was done, I looked over at her, and she was crying, and I didn't know if she was disappointed that it didn't happen, or maybe, like, she did get healed. And so later on, she said that no one came up to her, and she was praying for herself also to be healed, and she said she did get healed, and so just praise God, she got healed.
This guy was rooming with me. He's a cool guy.
So this is my first year at YFN, and I felt God's presence like a lot this week. But the main thing that I felt is, so at first I got prayed by Morgan, and he said, Dalton, you're a good man, and don't you ever forget that. And I could hear God telling me that I was a good man. So then I went to Pastor Aaron and got prayed for, and like as he was praying for me, I could feel something going through my chest and just beating. Like I could feel Jesus in my heart, like just, and I started crying. I don't know, like when he said my dad. Like, usually I would never cry about my dad, but in this, like, when we were at YFN, every time I heard about my dad, I started crying. And, when he said he prayed for all me and my family, I could just feel, like, us getting, like, I could see us getting closer, like, in my head, like, and it just made me cry. And it was awesome.
Like, everyone, give it up for my guys. Everyone experienced God. Y'all are good.
Tell you what we want is all of the campers to stand up. How about that? All of them. I know there was more than that. I saw 50 of them getting on the bus. Oh, that's right. We got some upstairs working, what have you. Y'all just keep standing for just a minute. What we want to do is pray. It's important that we just pray a hedge around all that the Lord has done. And what this does for you guys is creates momentum and motion. And when those things happen, the enemy loves nothing better than come to steal. That's what he does. And we don't want that to happen, that everything has fallen on good soil. And so, Father, we just pray right now for all of the experiences, Lord God, all of the phone calls that were received, for all of the prayers and all of the words that were spoken, and, Lord, every experience that they had, Father, every bit of it, Lord God, Lord, that it all has fallen on good soil. And, Lord God, that we just pray a hedge of protection around them, Father, that, Lord, that we as a body of Christ would just be good gardeners, that we would just keep the weeds away and keep it all the rocks out and just keep the enemy away. Father, just pray a hedge of protection, Lord, that this creates momentum and motion, Father, that in short time, that we have a space problem because of what you're going to bring forth through that youth group, and that we're going to have to struggle to find a place to put them all, Father. We pray that in Jesus' name, make that a good problem for us, Lord God. And Lord, just let it spill over into their families, Lord God, in relationships with siblings, in relationships with moms and dads, Lord God, in relationships with friends. Lord, let it spill over and let it be light and salt to others. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. I want to pray real quickly for my daughter. Come here, Kara. Don't start crying or anything. That wouldn't be fair. And I need some elders to get up here. And Tracy, come here. And we're going to pray over her. Are you going to share something? All right. For a long time, it's been in my daughter's heart to go to China. And, of course, I'm the daddy that said, no, 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 no. Well, and she's a big girl now. She's graduated from college, and my no is not quite as effective as it was a few years ago. And I did come to a point this year that I just said to her, okay, if you're going to do this, I'm behind you, I'm with you, but let's find a group that you can go with and, you know, just lay out some things where dad feels good, you know. And it's been in her heart for a long time. I mean, even to the extent that, what was it, a year or two ago, 2 years ago, she took sewing classes from Leonella, and with her own money, she bought material, and she made like 27 prayer bears and had them shipped to an orphanage in China. And that's been in her heart, is to go minister in a orphanage in China. So that's what she's doing. She leaves.
I leave Friday. The organization I'm going with is called Bring Me Hope, and what they do is they run summer camps. So I'm not actually going to an orphanage, but what they do is they bring an orphanage to us for a week, and we pay for the children to come. And a lot of the children are special needs, and most of them are, or they're girls, because those are the main groups of kids that get abandoned. And we pair up with a local university, so I'll be partnered up with a college-age translator who I'll be ministering to and telling the gospel to. And we'll have one or two children, and they'll be our children for the week. And we'll bathe them, we'll read them stories as they go to bed. A lot of them haven't eaten meat, so we'll be giving them meat for the first time and ice cream, and we'll be taking them to an amusement park. And my prayer is, I don't want them to see some foreigner coming in and showing them a good time, and then whenever I leave, it flees, and it will be like, you know, something so foreign to them. I want it to settle in them, and I know that the only thing that can stick inside of them and give them true hope is Jesus. Mm-hmm. And it's so hard to tell a special needs child or someone who believes in so many gods, who has never heard of someone who takes away all of their sin, has never heard those things before. So I want to have the right words to say, and I want it to be stuck to them like glue. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so that's my prayer. The Bible verse that we're, because it's a Christian organization, and the Bible verse that we have going into it that we're praying on is Zephaniah 3:19. It says, "At that time, I will deal with all who oppress you. I will rescue the lame. I will gather the exiles. I will give them praise and honor in every land where they have suffered." So that's what we're doing.
Everybody just pray with me. And Father, we do just, we send her out, Father. This is my daughter, and you've just given her to us, and how precious she is. And Lord, her heart is precious and tender and wants to serve you and wants to make a difference in this world. And Lord, this has been something in her heart for a long time, and now it's finally happening. And so, Father, we do praise you and thank you. And we just ask, Father, a hedge of protection around her. Lord, that you would guard her and shield her, Father, and the airport here and the airplane going there and the airport there and every transportation that she takes, everywhere that she goes, everything that she does, that you would just have angels assigned to her to protect her, Father. And Lord, even in the ability to minister and to be a witness, Lord God, that you would just give her wisdom, Lord, that she would be wise, and Lord, just seeing the opportunities and seizing them as you lay them out before her. It's an ordained trip, Father. You've ordained her steps. So, Father, we send her. We release her, Father, to you to go and to do your work. And I thank you, Father, for it. And I pray that every, Lord, desire of her heart, Lord, that you've birthed in her will spill out in this trip. And, Lord, she'll see it all come to pass. And it'll even be beyond what she could have imagined or thought, Lord God. And, Lord, that it will be a life-changing experience, not only for her, but for us as well when she returns. And thank you, Father, for her. And just thank you for all the provisions and everything that you've given to make it possible. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Thousands of years ago, God used Abraham to start something very exciting. When he paid Melchizedek the 10%, it wasn't about the tithe. It was the windows of heaven that he wanted to open up to us. He used that tithe, that act of Abraham by faith, to want to bless us. So when we participate in what Abraham started, what God started through Abraham, we're opening the windows of heaven. I don't know about you, but I'm glad the windows of heaven are open to me today. I am blessed. I am blessed. And I know many of us are, of course, into already paying our tithes. But, you know, we need to get into the offerings and to the almsgivings, because the more we give, it seems like the more we get blessed. Amen? How many of y'all be getting blessed? All right. So let's, this morning, as we hold our tithes and offerings in our hands, thank God that he is releasing the windows of heaven, Father. I just pray this blessings upon each one in this church. God, I thank you that we have more than enough. I thank you that our monthly bills are paid off, that we're in advance, that, Lord, we have money in the bank, not to satisfy our own lusts, but to be able to give out and to be able to invest in the kingdom of God. I thank you, Lord, that this is the house of God, that the word of God is going out to the ends of the earth. We're going to have increase in missions and churches being started. All of this is ahead of us. It's because we're giving of ourselves, our time, and our tithes and our offerings. And we praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sing a little more of that song we were doing a moment ago.
Let me know the kisses of your mouth. Let me feel your warm embrace. Let me smell the fragrance of your touch. Let me see your lovely face. Oh Lord, take me away. Even so, more than life.
Well, I started working on this sermon, and I praise the Lord that I kind of jotted down thoughts initially on Wednesday before I began to work on it on Friday, because I think after I received the news I heard on Friday, this thing would not turn out quite the same. I don't think you wanted to hear some of what my initial thoughts were on Friday. Maybe we'll get together now. I went through a range of emotions, and mostly anger, to be quite honest with you. I was very angry. And just the events of the recent weeks, and just here's the deal. You live in a messed up world. What else can you say? You know, from hate causing the murders that we saw in South Carolina, to ISIS on the other side of the ocean, to our own country deciding to change millenniums of the view of what a marriage is between a man and a woman, or that a Supreme Court all of a sudden creates laws. I don't quite understand that one either. But here's the deal. You ready? Doesn't change the message. It doesn't change the message. I sat there Friday night, and a pastor from San Antonio, he texts me, and, you know, I've processed so much and trying to figure out what I would say. And he sent me this. He said, same-sex marriage is now the law of the land. What is expected now from Christian organizations? We don't know yet. Will we take a stand if we need to? Question mark. And I shot back at him. Here's what we do. I just wrote back to him, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. What happened on Friday does not change the gospel. What happened on Friday does not change the message. It doesn't change truth. Doesn't change the fact that Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Doesn't change the fact that He's returning. Doesn't change the fact that all things will be dealt with. Same message that John the Baptist had when he got his head cut off. Jesus started preaching the same message. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. The message doesn't change for the church. The church is still light and the church is still salt. You just got a different atmosphere to be light and salt in. Matter of fact, if you got a weak light, it's shining brighter now because you're in a darker place. Well, here we are. I sat here and I thought, okay, Lord, because I had a nice sermon in my mind and heart on Friday, and I thought, boy, Lord, I don't, and the Lord wasn't in it, to be honest with you. It was my emotions, and He brought me back to Saturday to where I started in Nehemiah, and He said, just stay with that because nothing changes. And He said in Nehemiah 2, 15 through 20 is where our text has been. Here's Nehemiah just came off of this midnight journey. That's what we looked at last. He had that midnight journey where he walked the perimeter of the walls as much as he could. He looked at it. He surveyed it. He began to get a game plan of how that they were going to rebuild the walls and they were going to rebuild the gates. And he had not told anybody about what he was doing, what he was there for. But the enemy, Sanballat, he's already upset because he knows not only did he show up as the cupbearer of the king with written authority to do what he's going to do and the written authority to get the resources that he needs, he also shows up with the king's, what do I hear there? Somebody's phone. I don't know why my ears just go to music. I can't help it. If it had been a buzz, I wouldn't even pay attention to it, but it's music. But where was I? So Sanballat. Sanballat's all upset because he knows that he's there for the betterment of the Jews, and that's got him upset. And so Nehemiah comes off of this midnight journey that he took, inspecting the walls and the gates, and we pick it up in chapter 2 of verse 15. So I went up at night by the ravine and inspected the wall. Then I entered the valley gate again and returned. The officials did not know where I'd gone or what I had done. Nor had I as yet told the Jews, the priests, the nobles, the officials, the rest who did the work. Then I said to them, you see the bad situation that we are in. Hello. Do you see the bad situation that we are in? That Jerusalem is desolate and its gates burned by fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem so that we will no longer be a reproach. I told them how the hand of my God had been favorable to me, and also about the king's word which he had spoken to me. Then they said, let us arise and build. So they put their hands to the good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official and Geshem the Arab heard it, they mocked us and despised us and said, what is this thing you are doing? Are you rebelling against the king? So I answered them and said to them, the God of heaven will give us success. Therefore we his servants will arise and build, but you have no portion, no right or memorial in Jerusalem. Now, I wouldn't say that what I'm about to lay out to you are points. It's just observations, things that typically what I'll do when I go through a passage like that, I just begin as, okay, Lord, what are you saying out of this passage? And I just begin to highlight those things and then break those things into sections and just begin to dig and look and see what the Lord is saying in that. And the first thing that I notice out of that passage is that we are in this thing together. You can take that as a point or observation, don't really care, but it's just the truth. We are in this thing together. See, Nehemiah is the big shot that came from the king's court. He's the cupbearer. He's the guy who's been in the presence of the king, and he's had access to the king. He's had the king's favor. He's been able to counsel the king. And yet when he shows up, doesn't tell anybody what he's doing, once it gets to the point that he begins to address what he's there for, he very easily could begin to blast them and point the finger at them and say, what are you doing? How come you hadn't got this done? Playing the blame game, right? Nehemiah doesn't do that. Look at what Nehemiah does. Nehemiah uses words like we and us. He's not pointing fingers. He's being inclusive. He's including himself in the mess. He's saying, we are in a bad situation. We're in a mess. Come, let us build. Come, let us no longer be a reproach. You know, it's just like, in best example I can give you is in marriage counseling. And when I speak to someone in marriage counseling, particularly, you know, if I'm meeting with a husband and maybe my wife's met with the wife, either way, when I'm meeting with one person and I'm hearing them share their story, this is what's always in the back of my mind. There are two sides to a story. That's always in the back of my mind. It doesn't mean that that person's not being honest. Doesn't mean that they're lying to me. It just means that they're sharing with me their perspective, right? But there's someone else who has a different perspective. She's going to see it differently than he's kind of seeing things. Otherwise, we wouldn't have a conflict in the first place. There would be no point for marriage counseling because they'd both be on the same page, seeing the same things, in agreement, but they're not. They have two different stories. It's always true, see? And you don't accomplish anything by blaming the other. You know, a wife can't make his husband look good and herself look better. It's not going to happen. You're one. You're one flesh. There is no way to speak to your own flesh and try to make them look bad and you look good. It's not possible. Doesn't work. And here is Nehemiah understanding. He's not pointing the finger. He's not blaming. He's including himself. We're in a mess. And we got to rise up. We've got to do something. In terms of deliverance, in terms of salvation, in terms of what God's done in our life, guess what? Also, we are not alone. We can't do this thing by ourselves. And that's what Nehemiah is saying. He can't fix this thing by himself. We need one another. You know the verse, Proverbs 27:17. I hear this in men's ministry a lot. Iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. Meaning, it's not possible for this blade to get any sharper if it doesn't have contact. There must be contact. This is the only way that iron can sharpen iron. It must come in contact with one another. We need one another. Now, the enemy, on the other hand, What the enemy wants to do is isolate you. That's what he does. The enemy lies, the enemy accuses, the enemy blames, the enemy steals, kills, destroys, uses words, accusations, guilt, shame. But his ultimate goal is to divide and isolate. That's what he tries to do. That's his game plan. It's always his game plan. Divide and isolate. Because if he can divide and isolate, then he leaves you with your own thoughts, your own perspective, and all of a sudden your isolation becomes bars that ensnare you. That's the way the enemy works. I shared a story in the first service. When I was a young teenager, and we would go to this camp, a Christian camp in New Caney. Anybody know where New Caney's at? You go up Highway 59, up past Kingwood, and there was a farmer market road. You'd take that heading east into the the forest, and there would you'd come along near Caney Creek, New Caney Creek is what they called it, and there was a Baptist encampment built along that creek. And of course, like a lot of young people at camps, my favorite time was free time, right? And at free time, I would do just like what my son would do. You know, the apple doesn't fall very far from the tree. I'd do exactly what he would do. I would be down there at that creek. I would be looking for critters. I'd be looking for snakes. I'd be looking for turtles. I'd be looking for anything that crawls, that moves, makes a sound. I'm looking for it. I'm going to try to capture it if I can. And I remember one time coming down that creek, and there were it was a large sandbar, and it was covered with deer tracks. There were deer tracks upon deer tracks there. And they were going all kinds of different directions. And I walked a little bit further, and I came upon this hole. It was a shallow hole, and you could tell that an animal had been laying in it. But around this hole was paw tracks, like a big cat, like a mountain lion, cougar, whatever you call them. I don't know what you call them. Panther, I don't know. Big cat, big paws. And I went back, and I told my youth pastor, and he grew up in East Texas, and he knew a little bit about hunting, and he said, that's how they hunt. He said, they'll come near a herd, and it was just off the edge, kind of downstream a little bit from where the deer were, and said they'll make a hole there, and they'll scream into that hole, and it disperses their sound so that the deer can't tell exactly where that noise is coming from. But what it does is it causes fear, and it causes them to scatter, and they'll be running all over the place, and that cat will isolate one of them that's got off by themselves and pursues them, slays them, consumes them. And that's exactly what the enemy does. The enemy does the very same thing. Scripture says he's like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And he'll use anything that he can to get you to scatter and get you to isolate. When the truth is, guys, we're in this together. We're in this together, and we need each other. I need you. Sadly to say, I'm sorry, you need me too. You're incomplete without me, and I'm incomplete without you. That's the collective heart that Nehemiah had when he said, let us rebuild. Let us build. The second observation is that building the wall, when he called them to rebuild that wall, he also asked them, let's remove the reproach. Let's remove the reproach. What Nehemiah was calling the people to do was to unite, to rebuild what had been destroyed or had been broken, to improve their situation, to remove a condition of disgrace. Reproach is literally to be in a condition where scorn and shame and disgrace, you're left vulnerable to scorn and ridicule because of your condition, where your condition has left you open to your enemy to be scorned and to be taunted. But what God has done for us is that God has taken us, He's saved us, He's moved us out of the kingdom of darkness, placed us into the kingdom of light. He's given us His Holy Spirit so that we have a helper, that we don't stay the same, that we are continually becoming and being saved in our soul and being changed. That's why 2 Timothy 1:7 says, for God has not given us a spirit of timidity, but of power and love and discipline, or sound mind, whichever word you want to use, but they mean the same. What that word means is that it's given us the ability to make right choices and right decisions. God's empowered us with His Holy Spirit for the purpose of power, for the purpose of love, the ability to love even the unlovely, to even forgive those who seem unforgivable. He's given us the ability to do that by His Spirit. He's given us the ability to have self-discipline and self-control. When we had our Father's Day's message, that was one of the points, is that men, real men, have self-control, sound mind. Because sin can make the brightest man do the stupidest things, but it can also take the foolish things and confound the wise. God's not given us a spirit of timidity, but boldness, self-control, love. The word discipline literally means that we are level-headed. We make right decisions and we live above reproach. It's what Philippians chapter 2 says in verse 14. Do all things without grumbling or disputing, so that you will prove yourselves to be blameless and innocent, children of God, above reproach in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation among whom you appear as lights in the world. I wrote under my notes, you've never had more of an opportunity to fulfill that scripture as you do right now. Though the world may be a mess, you are light in darkness. You're to be blameless and above reproach. It isn't automatic. It doesn't happen by osmosis. Even for Israel here, the temple was functioning, but the walls and the gates were down. And the walls and the gates are not going to build up themselves. The people have to rise up and do it. But the truth is, the world's not going to get better just because we're nice people. Hello? The world's going to get better because we're right. We must rise up and rebuild this broken world. But you cannot do it alone, and I can't do it alone either. We rebuild the walls. Scripture teaches us that we're to encourage one another and build one another up. We are stones that are being fit together. We are the church. We're the body of Christ collectively. You and I, we are the light and we are the salt. The third thing I see in this is that God is on our side. Amen. I like that. God is on our side. I don't know. You know, it seems to change by the second these days, but I do know how it ends. See, that's what's wonderful. There's a final chapter here that I can go to. You ever done that? You're reading a book, kind of get a little bored about third or fourth chapter, and let me scoot on ahead and see what this thing turns out here. We know how it turns out. I know the ending of the story. God is on our side. Verse 18 says, I told them how the hand of my God had been favorable to me. What Nehemiah did at this point says, I began to tell them that my whole journey, even bringing me to the place of being a cupbearer, has been the hand of God on my life to bring me to this point right now, this place in history right now. And then he began to tell them how, because he was the cupbearer, how he had favor with the king, and he actually was given and released by the king, given the time, an allotted amount of time. Guess what? Our God has given us an allotted amount of time to do some things on this earth. The king released Nehemiah for an allotted amount of time. He also resourced him. He resourced him with authority. Guess what? The King of Kings has released us with authority. When he ascended into heaven, he says, all power and authority is given to me. Go ye therefore. We've been resourced. He says, I must go so that the helper may come. We've been resourced with the power of the Holy Spirit, just like Nehemiah. God's on our side. He was telling him all these things of how God had resourced him and given him favor. And Nehemiah begins to stir the people, sharing his testimony of what God had done and brought him to this place. And then he says these words, the God of heaven will give us success. Well, guess what? I know of a man named Paul who said, God is for us, so who can be against us? Hebrews 13:5 says he will never leave us nor forsake us. The Supreme Court is limited in its reach. There is a throne that is above all thrones. And that throne is on our side. Every wrong decision that's ever been made upon this earth will be overturned. There is a day when the King of Kings is going to return and he's going to call his court into session. You don't want to be one of the five. And I'm not being cute. Our God is with us and our God is for us, and we will have success. We are the bride of Christ, the bride who is making herself ready. pure and spotless bride. I wrote in my notes, it says, if Friday's decision upset you, and I pray that it did, understand this. God is waiting on His bride. God is waiting on His bride to rise up and rebuild. God is waiting on His bride to get up and do what she's supposed to be doing in the earth. A church that realizes the authority and the power and the resources that He's given her in this set amount of time, in this very hour. Because see, God was not caught off guard. He doesn't bite His fingernails. We do that. We're the ones that have anxiety and things like that. God doesn't have anxiety attacks. He's not caught off guard. It's a complacent church that gets caught off guard. Do you think that the seven churches in Revelations existed in a society that wasn't reprobate or depraved? Do you think that Jesus, in the time that He walked the earth under Roman oppression, didn't live in a depraved or an oppressed world? He certainly did. Think of the Christians that for 300 years that lived under persecution. They lived in a depraved and a messed up world. And you do too. It's not the hour to wimp out. It's the hour to get serious. Serious about what God's doing in your own life. Serious about what God's doing in your family. Serious about what God is doing in the earth. Rise up, church, and rebuild. And the fourth thing that stands out to me out of that passage, and I can't help it when it happens this way, it's just how it happens. But when. But when. That's my fourth observation. But when Sanballat heard it, but when Sanballat heard what Nehemiah was intending on doing, he got a little upset. And matter of fact, if you go through Nehemiah through the first six chapters, what you find is a cycle of opposition. If you're not doing anything for the kingdom, you can go through life just fine. But when you start moving forward and God's moving forward in your life, you're messing up darkness around you. When you're gaining ground, He's losing ground. You can expect opposition. When Sanballat first saw them come into town, even though he didn't know what they were there for to do, but he sees that not only has he got a letter of authority, but he's also accompanied by the king's captains and the king's horsemen. He's grieved, it says in chapter 2, verse 10. He's grieved because he knows that he's there to do something good for the Jews, and it grieves him. And then we see in 19, once he lays out his plan in verse 19, it says, really, he began to laugh at Nehemiah, began to mock him. You're going to be laughed at and mocked by what you believe and what you stand for. You can count on it. Trying to make him look stupid in front of the masses. Because, see, it's really easy to do at this point because the walls are still laying in ruin. The gates are still burned. So here he is laying out this crazy plan. We're going to rebuild the walls and we're going to rebuild the gates. Oh, really? You're a fool. That's what he's telling me. And trying to make him look foolish in front of everybody. That's what the enemy does. Then he shifts into anger and indignation. Why? Because he starts seeing a wall going up. So now he's not laughing anymore. Now he's angry. He's angry and he's got indignation. Now the walls are still going up and it's being completed and his anger has got to turn into action. So we see in chapter 4, verse 7 through 8, now he's fighting. Now he's bringing real conflict and fighting against them. He's angry. He's trying to cut them off. He's trying to keep them from doing what they're supposed to do. The walls are no longer, there's no longer any breaches in the walls at this point. They can't come and go and do what they want to any longer. Their patterns and their habits are being stopped. And now the gates aren't fixed yet, but they've got warriors at the gates. They're not allowing the traffic to just come and go. And now he moves from fighting because that's not working to now being subtle and crafty. If you look in chapter 6, verse 1 through 2, you can look at it at your own. He begins to move into craftiness and being coy and trying to stop and impede the process and the work. But that's beginning to fail. So here's his last move. He begins to try compromise. He tries reasoning. But see, here's the deal. You can't reason with the devil. You can't reason with the devil. no matter how much truth is there, you put one lie with a bunch of truth, it still equals a lie. It don't come out any other way. The devil's a liar. He's always been a liar. That's all he can do. He's not capable of telling the truth. So, you don't compromise with him. You don't reason with him. We'll walk through some of these cycles a little bit later. But Nehemiah surveys the work and he makes appeal to the people. He says, we're in a mess, guys. We're in a mess. Let's do something about it. Let's arise. Let's rebuild. Let's get off our backside. God's for us. He's with us. And Sanballat's grieved at this moment. And then he begins to laugh and he begins to mock and bring deception. And it's an evil laugh. I just can hear it. It's an evil laugh. Verse 19, but when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official and Geshem the Arab heard it, they mocked us. It's literally what it means. They mocked us and despised us and said, what is this thing you're doing? And then Nehemiah uses these awesome words that I'm going to paraphrase for you. I think this might stick better in your head. You ready? He said, get off my construction site. That's what he said. Get off my construction site. Sanballat is not allowed on the construction site. Verse 20, so I answered them and said to them, the God of heaven will give us success. Therefore, we, his servants, will arise and build, for you have no portion, no right, and no memorial in Jerusalem. No portion. What's he saying? You have no claim. You have no parcel. You have no position, no possession, no share, no ground, no claim of territory. Get off of my construction site. You don't have a permit here. Get off. It says, you have no right. You have no legal standing. You have no authority. Your words are uncredited here. You have no legal written authority. Get off of my construction site. It says, you have no memorial. You have no reminder, no remembrance, no sign here. You have no history here. You have no belonging here. You have no heritage here. This is not your God-given place. Get off of my construction site. I don't know how to draw you a clearer picture of what it means for your soul. See, some of you have gotten, you've gotten your butt kicked too much. Yeah. Let's just lay it down. You've gotten kicked around too much. And the truth is, Sanballat has no right to be there in the first place. That's the purpose of your soul. That's the purpose of renewing your mind. It's not legalism why you read the word. It's not legalism why you obey it. It's because it's a parameter to your soul so that you'll make right decisions. You'll live with discipline. You'll live with soundness of mind. That you'll be above reproach. When you pick elders and you pick deacons, that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to look for folks who live that way, who are above reproach. So when you announce, oh, we're looking at these candidates, we'll say, if anybody knows a reason why they shouldn't be, say it. What does that mean? We're looking for people who are above reproach. There's no place for accusation because their mind is sound and they live by right decisions. They live by what they say and what they believe. I'm sorry, I just say it. You know, there's no safe place to get your news. No. Listening to Megyn Kelly closing out her little news set and closes with a homosexual celebrating what's taking place, and he says, because I'm a homosexual who's a Christian. Wait a minute. That's an oxymoron, folks. And I'm not trying to be ugly. I'm not. But, you know, either this is true or it's not true. Because, you see, it was, for such were some of you. You were that, but you are no longer, because you've been trained, changed, and transformed inside. You can't have a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. It's supposed to change you from kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Not only are you saved by the fruit of your lips, that you're the righteousness of God because Jesus lives in you, you live like it, you act like it, you think like it. And he says, you know, memorial. You've no reminder here. I thought that was interesting. You've no memorial here in Jerusalem. No heritage here. What does that mean? I think of it the same way Jesus responded in John 14, 30 when he says, I will not speak much more with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. And he has nothing in me. Nothing in me. That we have nothing in common. That we have been cleansed from all unrighteousness. That we are actually the righteousness of God because Jesus lives inside of us. That, this is the best way I can say it, it's a nightmare for daytime television. Because when they check my DNA and they match it against Father Satan, I'm not his kid. I'm not his kid. My DNA does not match his. My Father God, my DNA matches his. My sinful nature has been dealt with. Because homosexuality is not the only thing that can put you in hell. Being a whoremonger can put you in hell as well. Any other form of sin. That's why Jesus said, you know, Scripture says you should not commit adultery. Well, I tell you, if you lust in your heart after another woman, you're guilty of adultery already. Scripture says that you should not murder. But I tell you, if you hate your brother in your heart, you're guilty of murder already. We're just talking about sin. He dealt with my sin issue. He changed my DNA. He changed who I am. Because he changed who I am, God says he has wiped my sins away. There is no memorial here for you, Satan. My sins are as far as the east is from the west. You have no memorial here. Get off my construction site. You see, I am a construction site. I have been bought by the blood of Jesus. I am not my own. I belong to him. And Mark, I don't know where you got it from, if you came up with it or not, but it's brilliant because it's true that I was saved. My spirit was saved the moment I received Jesus into my life, confessed my sin. He's my Lord and Savior. I know that he died for me on the cross and what he did for me on Calvary, that I was a sinner and I needed his atonement and what he did for me on the cross. He has washed my sins away. I thank you, Lord Jesus. Your word says you're faithful and just to forgive me of all my sins if I confess it, and I did. And I believe that you are the Son of God, that you died upon the cross, that you were buried, that you're resurrected from the grave. I know you're my Lord, my Savior, and guess what? His life came into me. I'm born again. My spirit has been saved. Yeah, but my soul is being saved. Because I got a lot of junk. I got some habits, and I got some strongholds, and I got some things, the way I think, and opinions, and worldviews, and all kinds of mess going on in my soul that aren't right. And I press into him. And as I press into him, he begins to change me and conform me. Because I'm a construction site. He who has began a good work in me is faithful to complete it. He's constructing me. He's rebuilding me. He's reforming me. He's changing me. Devil, you're fired. Get off of my construction site. You have no place here. You have no parcel here. You have no right here. You don't have a permit to be here. Get off of my construction site. You have no memorial here. All the accusations that you throw at me are lies. I once was, I am no longer. I'm no longer looking at what lays behind me. I'm pressing on to what's ahead because you have no memorial. God wants to rebuild your heart. He wants to rebuild your mind. He wants to rebuild your thoughts. He wants to rebuild your habits. Arise and rebuild. It doesn't mean you're not going to make mistakes. You will. We have an advocate. What does that mean? You got a lawyer. You got a lawyer, and he's not going to send you a bill. He's going to represent you, and it's going to be good. He's going to say, you don't have anything on him. Blood of Jesus. What? Matter of fact, what did you say he did? No, it's not even there. Not even there. It says he's blotted out my sins. That's what it says he's done. Move on. Move on. Arise and rebuild. And this message, I think, is I find, and I think partly for men, because I are one, I understand men a little better than I do women, because I ain't one. She is. And she's from bone, I'm from dirt. We're different, you know. But I think some of these things are still understandable because we're all human, and we all struggle. We all have habits and things that need to be changed. But, you know, I say to men these days, I'm not going to say it's easy, guys. We got to quit making wimps because it's not easy. It's not easy to say no to pornography. That's difficult. You know, when I was a young man, pornography, you had to get in your car and go get it. You don't have to do that no more. I'd hate to be 15-year-old raising up in this world right now of the things that are accessible and thrown in their face. And so it's not easy. It's not always easy to say no. But it is a fruit of the Spirit to have self-control. So as you press into Him and you allow Him to begin to change you and you just get dead dog determined, get sick of that thing, tell the devil to get off of the construction site. You have no place here. You have no right here. You have no grounds here. You have no authority here. You have no memorial here. You can quit calling me those things because I am not that. I love what Mattress Mac said. He said, when you fail, look at that and say, that's not me. When you do good, look at that and say, now that's me. That's what you do. Because the enemy wants to get you to look at the failure and say, that's me. No, that used to be me. That is not me. I am this over here, and I'm pressing in for it. And if you mess up, you dust it off, Lord, forgive me. I'm moving on. I'm pressing on. I'm going to get through this thing. Self-discipline's not easy. Self-control's not easy, but it's necessary. Amen? So I just want you right now, I want everybody to just stand up. Let's do that. Close your eyes for a moment. Whatever that area in your life might be, what area is out of control, out of kilter, that area in your soul where God's still forming and changing you, and maybe some area where you've struggled with. It's time to tell the enemy, get off my construction site. That's what you need to do right now. Just tell him right now, get off of the construction site. You don't belong here. You've got no right here. You've got no permit whatsoever. You have no memorial here. I'm not listening to your lies of what you tell me I used to be. I'm not that. I'm telling you who I am. I'm more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. Amen. That's who I am. And just make a renewed commitment to press into Him. The Lord, you would change us and make us and mold us who we're supposed to be. We are the righteousness of God because Jesus lives in us. And Lord, we want that to be evident. We want that to be transpire. We want it to manifest itself out of us, Lord God. Let it flow out of us into every area of our life. Lord, that our very lives would become a testimony to you and a sacrifice of praise to you, because we're being conformed to your image. And we want to do it for no other reason but that we love you, Lord God. We love you and we need you. And help us to be light and salt above reproach. Help us to make a difference in the world we live. Help us to be solid and consistent, Lord God. Help us to not be afraid. Help us to not be timid. Help us to be bold. We're not going to change this world just because we're nice people. We're going to change this world because we're right people, because of you. That you've put everything inside of us, your spirit, your word is written on our heart. Lord, even truth, Lord God, that we'd not shy away from truth. Doesn't mean we have to be ugly. We just want to be consistent and constant and sure. We want to be, Father, who you've called us to be, that we are the light. We are the salt. Help us to be that. And I pray for deliverance. I pray for testimony of deliverances that come out of this place. Some of those strongholds, it might be smoking. It could be, you know, some physical addiction that you're needing to overcome. It could be that anger gets the best of you. You don't even know why. Being ugly to others, and you don't even know why. And you find your own self disappointed in yourself later because you did that, because you just got a habit of doing it. Help us break those things, Lord. Rebuild us, who we are, how we think, how we act. Lord, that the fruit of the Spirit, gentleness, kindness, meekness, self-control, all of those things from the fruit of your Spirit, Lord, would be exhibited in our lives, I pray. And Lord, we just want to receive that, Lord God, right now, in Jesus' name, I pray. And I want to ask as we close, if anybody needs prayer for healing, if you need prayer just to receive Jesus, if you need prayer for a brother or sister to come and to agree with you, this area in your life that you're going to have the boldness and the determination to overcome, to tell the enemy, no longer, no mas, no more, not putting up with it, get off my construction site. You come forward. We want to pray with you. If you need healing, come forward. We want to pray with you. If you don't know Jesus, if this is a little foreign to you, come forward. We'd love to talk with you about that. Whatever your need is, if you need prayer, come forward. We'll have those that will pray with you. And if those that remain, if you need to go, we understand that, but we're going to worship just for a moment.
Jesus, I love you. For when I was blind and lost, you shed for all your enemies, your blood upon the cross. Because you have loved me, now I can love you too. Love flows deep into my heart, and I send it back to you. Jesus, I love will only grow much deeper, sustained from above by your overflowing grace. Someday we shall be together, face to face. Jesus, I love you. Was blind and lost, you shed for all your enemies, your blood upon the cross. Because you have loved me, now I can love. send it back to you. Jesus, our love will only grow much deeper, sustained from above by your overflowing grace. Your blood upon